Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Harrowing by Alexandra Sokoloff, narrated by Rebecca Mitchell. Prologue. The memorial was buried deep in an oak grove in the heart of campus, a graceful arc of trees, and the curved marble bench. On this late November day, the grove was dark and hushed, just a whisper of rain that dripped from the thick canopy of branches leaked down onto the aged marble, streaking the stone with black, like tears. Vines and brambles had crept over the path, cutting off access to the quiet circle, leaving the bench all but forgotten now, like the students whose names it bore. Above the layer of rotting leaves covering the seat, they were cut into the marble like names on a tombstone. Five names, a date, and a simple epitaph. In memoriam. Five students dead, so long ago. What could it matter now? Chapter 1. It had been raining since possibly the beginning of time. In the top tier of the cavernous psychology hall, Robin Stone had long since given up on the lecture. She sat hunched in her seat, staring out arched windows at the downpour, feeling dreamily disconnected from the elemental violence outside, despite the fact that every few minutes the wind shook the building hard enough to rattle the glass of the window panes. In milder weather, Baird College was the very definition of pastoral. Wooded paths meandered between ivy-swathed stone buildings. Grassy hills rolled into the distance, dotted by trees, all unmarred by the slightest sight of civilization. But now the old oaks lashed in the wind under roiling dark clouds that spilled icy rain on the deserted quad. In the bleak light of the storm, the isolation seemed ominous. The campus hunkered down under the pelting rain like a medieval town waiting for the siege. The cold of the day had sunk into Robin's bones. The wind outside was droning in her ears, like the hollow rush of the sea. Inside, Professor Lister's soft German accent was soporific, strangely hypnotic, as he quoted Freud from the wood-planked dais far below.
The state of sleep involves a turning away from the real external world, and there we have the necessary condition for the development of a psychosis. The harmless dream psychosis is the result of that withdrawal from the external world, which is consciously willed, and only temporary.
Robin's moody reflection stared back at her from the window, dark-eyed, somewhat untidy elfin features framed by a tumble of nearly black hair. All in all, a chance of prettiness, if she weren't so withdrawn. Guarded. She pulled away from the glassy ghost of herself, blinked around her at a sea of students moored behind tiers of wooden desks. People were shifting restlessly, looking up at the clock above the headboard. A little before 3:00, Wednesday. Tomorrow was Thanksgiving, and everyone was impatient, eager to escape for the holiday. Everyone except Robin. The 4-day weekend loomed before her like an abyss. Thanksgiving. Right. Thanks for what? At least there would be no roommate. She sat with the thought of no Waverly for 4 days and felt a spark of something. Not pleasure. Nothing so life-affirming as that. But a slight relief. A loosening of the concrete band that lately seemed to permanently encircle her chest. No mindless venal chatter. No judging cornflower blue eyes. And no one else either, Robin reminded herself. No one at all. The anxiety settled in again, a chill of unnamed worry. 4 days in creepy old Mendenhall. Completely alone. The professor's soft voice whispered in the back of her head.
In psychosis, the turning away from reality is brought about either by the unconscious repressed becoming excessively strong so that it overwhelms the conscious, or because reality has become so intolerably distressing that the threatened ego throws itself into the arms of the unconscious, instinctual forces in a desperate revolt.
Robin glanced down at the professor, startled at the confluence of thought. She wrote slowly, "Reality has become so intolerably distressing." She stopped and quickly scribbled over the words, blacking them out. Somewhere close, another pen scratched furiously across paper. Robin glanced toward the sound. Across the aisle from her, a slight, intense, bespectacled young man was hunched in his seat, scribbling notes as if his life depended on it. A mini tape recorder on the desk in front of him recorded the lecture as well, in the unlikely event that he missed something. Robin had seen him a few times around the dorm. Pale skin and hollow circles under his eyes behind his glasses, shoulders hunched under the weight of an overstuffed backpack, always scurrying to or from class, as scattered and distracted as the white rabbit. He looked younger than the other students, and older, too. Probably skipped a grade or two and rushed into college early, full throttle, driven by parents or some inner demon of his own. Robin knew something about that. She studied him, feeling relief in concentrating her attention on something outside of herself. There was a coldness about him, an ancient guardedness that she recognized as unhappiness. His face, always set and unsmiling, if possible, more tense and miserable than Robin herself. Yet there was something luminous about him as well, almost holy. Something like a monk in his ascetic intensity. She thought these things with detachment, as if from a great distance, merely observing. It did not occur to her to speak to him, or smile, or communicate in any way. It did not seem to her that they were on the same dimensional plane. She watched him through glass as she watched the storm. So she was completely caught off guard when he turned and looked her straight in the eyes. She stared back, startled. He immediately blushed behind his glasses and dropped his gaze to his yellow pad. Robin sat, flustered. The bells in the clock tower above the main plaza outside struck once, sounding the three-quarter hour. A hollow sound, reverberating over the campus. On the podium below, the white-haired professor paused, listening to the bell. The chime died, and he turned back to the class. But while Freud contended that the forces that drive us come from within us, our own unconscious, his disciple and colleague Jung believed there was a universal unconscious around us, populated by ancient forces that exist apart from us, yet interact with us and act upon us. He paused, looked around at the class.
So, who was right? Do our demons come from without or within us?
He half smiled, then closed his binder.
End on that cheery note. We'll end early, since I know you're all eager to get away.
The class collectively surged to its feet, reaching for coats and notebooks and backpacks in an orgy of release. The professor raised his voice over the tide.
I'll need all of you to discuss your term paper topics with me next week, so please make appointments by email. Have a good Thanksgiving.
Robin closed her notebook and stood, feeling as if she were rising through water, but only partway. The surface seemed far above her. She came through the double wooden doors of the psych building on a moving sea of students. The cold slapped her out of her sleepy daze, and she halted on the wide marble steps of the building, blinking out over the quad. Raindrops splashed on her face, ran down into the collar of her shapeless wool coat. In the distance, the clock tower chimed the hour. Three reverberating bongs, a sound of release and doom. So now it begins, Robin thought, and had no idea what she meant. Students jostled her from behind, pushing her along down the steps. She fumbled in her backpack for her umbrella, forced it up above her head, and joined the streams of students surging through the uneven stone plaza. She looked at no one, spoke to no one. No one looked at her. She could have been a ghost. In the 2 months she'd been at Baird, she'd made exactly zero friends. It wasn't that she was a monster. With her fine, pale features and thick, dark hair, she had a darkling, changeling quality, intriguing, almost elemental. No, she wasn't hideous. It was just that she was invisible. She'd been in a fog of darkness for so long, it seemed to have dissolved her corporeal being. She walked on blankly. Rain wept down the Gothic arches and neoclassic columns of the buildings around her, whispered through the canopies of oak. Someone else, someone normal, would have felt a moody pleasure in the agelessness of it. Any kind of adventure could be waiting over a stone bridge, under an ancient archway. By all rights, she should have been wild with joy just to be there, with a, let's face it, lunatic mother who in her best, properly medicated periods was barely able to hold on to temp work. Robin would never have been able to afford a school like Baird. Even with her grades, the AP classes she'd loaded up on, hoping against hope that the extra credits would get her a scholarship and out. The scholarship hadn't come. But a miracle had. Her father, known to her only as a signature on a monthly child support check, had come through with a college fund. Full tuition at his alma mater. A few strings pulled, a favor called in from a college pal on the board, and Robin was in. Free. Saved. It had nothing to do with love, of course. Robin knew the money was guilty penance for abandoning his defective daughter to her defective mother. Who wouldn't have fled long ago? Only I couldn't, Daddy. Could I? He had a new family now. Perfect golden wife. Two perfect golden children. A voice in her head rose up, taunting her. He threw you away. Cast off. Cast out. You're nothing. Nothing. She gasped in, for a moment almost choking on her own volcanic anger. Then she pushed it back down into the dark. When his letter came, her mother had raged and cried for days. Robin ignored the hysterics, coldly cashed the check and packed her bags. Take his guilt money and get the hell out, fuck you very much. But get out to where? The school was fine. She was the one who was all wrong. There was some fatal heaviness about her, a yawning black hole in the center of her that repelled people. They could see her darkness, her bitter, bitter envy of the light. She'd escaped Mom, but was still surrounded by herself. Nothing but herself for the next 4 days. And if she started hearing voices, alone in the dark, gloomy hall? Well, there was always the full bottle of Valium in Waverly's bottom drawer. More than enough to end it. The thought was cold comfort as she walked through the wind. Chapter 2. The exodus had already begun. Students with bulging luggage poured out the front door of Mendenhall and down the steps in a steady stream. Robin came up the rain-drenched walk, blankly sidestepping residents climbing into cars and airport shuttle vans idling in the circular drive that set Mendenhall apart from the other Victorians lining the west edge of campus. Mendenhall Residence Hall, known to all as The Hall, sometimes M Hall, sometimes even Home, was a converted mansion, a sprawling hodgepodge of turrets, balconies, fire escapes, and gabled roofs, all under a spreading canopy of oaks. Once a fraternity house, until the campus had started admitting women in 1932, it looked like some mad designer had added a wing in every direction from every architectural style and period ever since. Under the dark skies, it was as gloomily gothic as anything Hawthorne or Poe had ever conjured from the fevered depths of their imaginations. Robin moved up the steps, past students hoisting duffels and carry-on bags, hugging and shouting goodbyes. Their raucous put-downs and farewells seemed to come from a great distance, barely audible. It was so easy for them. The normals. Vacation, friends, love. They bubbled over with life and enthusiasm, fairly scorching her with their light. She pushed down the black surge of envy and stepped through the triple-arched front door into a murky entry hall lined with rows of locked mailboxes. She hesitated by the boxes. Her hand slid automatically into her coat pocket for keys, even as a voice in her head mocked her. "Why bother? You know it's empty. Spare yourself and go upstairs." She pulled the keys out of her pocket, quickly jabbed the smallest into the keyhole of her box, and pulled open the door. Empty. "See? Nothing. Nothing. You're nothing." Robin shoved the mailbox door closed to shut out the voice. She twisted the key, turned away blindly. The entry opened into a decrepitly grand but effectively useless hall. Benches with high backs like church pews hugged the paneled walls. Across the hardwood floor, veneer long worn away, a sweeping staircase led up to three floors of big old rooms with diamond-cut bay windows and recessed window seats. On this dark day, the two-story hall felt more cavernous than usual. Ominous, even. Robin paused in the doorway, looking up. She'd never noticed how the high windows near the top of the balcony looked like watching eyes. "Just stop it," Robin ordered herself. "You're staying, and the last thing you need to do is start freaking yourself out about this." She crossed the bare floor to the staircase and made her way up, her legs still stiff with cold. The wide steps, of shiny old wood with carpet runners for safety, felt slightly spongy under her feet, beginning to give under the constant tramping traffic of 60-some residents per year. Robin's nostrils flared with the familiar scent of Mendenhall. An old smell, sickly sweet, a little musty, accumulated layers of dusty carpet and wet wood vying with laundry detergent, pot, stale beer, sweat, lingering perfume, and sex, of course. Always sex. On the second floor, she turned to the right and walked the length of the landing into an enclosed staircase leading up to the third floor. In the dark, she pulled up short at a sudden movement right above her. A guy with straggly hair and linen glasses brushed past her on his way out, duffel slung over his shoulder. He mumbled, "Sorry," not looking at her. Robin started up the last flight of stairs without bothering to respond. Her own floor was the third on the girls' wing. Not that anyone enforced the segregation. Students went back and forth between all the wings at all hours of the night, and everyone but the housing office knew the hall supervisor was living with his girlfriend in a flat three blocks away. She stepped through the open door to the third floor and was assaulted by pre-vacation music blasting from various rooms in a mind-boggling cacophony. Green Day, the Sex Pistols, the Marriage of Figaro from some high-toned rebel. Robin walked down the carpeted hall, the open doors on both sides of the corridor revealing girls throwing clothes and books into duffels and backpacks, rushing in and out of one another's rooms with college-age disregard for personal space, shouting cheerful goodbyes. As she passed a doorway, the group inside burst into laughter. Robin stiffened. Were they laughing at her? The shapeless Goodwill coat with holes in its pockets? Her worn shoes? No one was looking. They didn't see. Her steps slowed as she neared her room. The door was closed, but she could tell Waverly was there from the twist in her gut. Should I go somewhere? Wait till she's gone? She hesitated, deliberating. Oh, well. She'll be out soon enough. She reached reluctantly for the doorknob and went in. Robin's roommate was packing half her closet into a Louis Vuitton bag on her perfectly made bed and, thankfully, was too busy dictating her travel plans and retrieval instructions into a cell phone to do more than glance huffily at Robin. Robin crossed to the far corner of her side of the room, stripped off her wet clothes, found a long sweater on the floor to pull on over her leggings. She kept her back to her roommate, who traveled peevishly from her closet to the suitcase on the bed as if she were alone in the room. Waverly Todd was beautiful. Apart from that, she had no redeeming qualities. Certainly, she must have been punishment for some terrible transgression in one of Robin's past lives. A preening, prissy, size 2 Southern belle, she could take up the whole room and all the oxygen in it, no matter what she was doing. She had followed her football scholarship boyfriend out of Charleston to the hinterlands, a fish out of water in the cold East. She hated everyone around her with a black passion. The girl clearly belonged in a sorority and had, in fact, been firmly interred in the Tri-Delta House, most prestigious on campus until this year. Robin gathered that during rush week, there had been some incident with the boyfriend that got Waverly kicked out of the house and the boyfriend ousted from his frat as well. Waverly was fighting mad about her expulsion from the Greek Golden Circle into the outer darkness of general housing. She raged against her banishment and took her fall from grace out on Robin, the lowly civilian, by being generally insufferable in every way she could invent. Robin's only consolation was that her very existence was as annoying to Waverly as Waverly's was to her. Robin hung her detested coat to dry above the radiator, dug her Ancient Worlds textbook out of her backpack, and curled in the window seat with her back to the other girl. The room itself was fantastic, really. Diamond-beveled windows, a cozy, creaking, recessed window seat, delicious dark mahogany paneling up half of the wall. But the decor was a battlefield, lines strictly drawn. Waverly's half of the room was fussily, oppressively feminine. Laura Ashley linens and cut crystal knickknacks perkily punctuated with various plush stuffed animals, a framed photo of the boyfriend on the dresser. Robin's half was dark and cryptic and arty. Black sheets and worn surrealist prints on the wall, the melted Dalí watches a defiant blot in Waverly's Laura Ashley universe. Waverly finally hung up on whatever relative she was torturing and turned her full attention back to her suitcase. Robin bent over her book. She had no intention of actually studying, but she kept up the pretense of reading to annoy Waverly. It was working. Waverly watched Robin suspiciously, irritated to paranoia by Robin's stoic refusal to acknowledge her presence. The silence fairly crackled between them. Finally, Waverly had to speak. "You're not going home?" Robin turned a page, not looking up. "No." "You're just going to stay here? By yourself?" Robin's eyes never moved from the book. "Looks like it." Waverly's gaze narrowed, her drawl lengthened. "You never go anywhere, you know." Robin's voice was flat. "I must be weird or something." "Or something," Waverly sniffed. The door crashed open, and a tall, broad jock filled the doorframe. The boyfriend. In the window seat, Robin stiffened, every molecule of her being instantly aware of him. If Waverly was a black hole, Patrick O'Connor was the sun, big and blonde and full of life. Robin could feel her heart lifting, hope returning. He swaggered into the room, duffel hanging from his shoulder.
"Taxi's here,"
he complained in Waverly's direction, Southern accent rich as butter.
"Ready to roll?"
Waverly continued rearranging her suitcase, adding outfits she had no chance in hell of wearing over the 4-day break. "He'll wait," she knifed back. Robin kept her eyes glued to her book, raging inwardly. Why Waverly? It was always the golden, stupid ones who were chosen. It was pathetic, really. A typical Southern disaster in the making. High school quarterback fucking what brains there were out of the prom queen. Prom queen bent on marriage. Quarterback overflowing with hormones, scamming on every other girl in sight. As if to illustrate the point, Patrick ran his hand along the curve of Waverly's ass as she bent over her suitcase. She pushed him away. Unfazed, Patrick twisted his hand in her hair and pulled her head back to kiss her, full mouth grazing on her lips, dropping lower to nuzzle on her throat. Robin's jaw tightened. She pretended not to watch. Pathetic. Even more pathetic was that against all logic and better judgment, Robin was hopelessly in lust with him. It was a stupid cliché, doomed, she knew. But Patrick was the only person at the school who'd paid any attention to her at all, who smiled when he saw her, as if she weren't broken or damaged beyond repair. Granted, he lighted up for everyone, especially when he wanted something. But at least Robin felt there when he was around. At least he saw her. He saw her. She'd listened to them make love in the dark, not knowing or caring that she was awake, and imagined herself under him, his mouth on her throat, his hands holding her down, his heat filling her. She started back to the present as Patrick turned Waverly loose and flashed his grin at Robin, warm and brilliant.
"Hey, Rob. Could not motivate myself out of bed this morning. I miss anything in ancient Civ?"
A direct blue gaze. Irresistible. Robin closed her book on her finger, kept her voice casual. "Besides that next Friday's the midterm?" Patrick's look was comically dismayed.
"Fuck a duck. I'll choke."
His voice dropped, low and caressing.
"Less I can get your notes."
The Carolina drawl that was like fingernails on a blackboard from Waverly was a lingering tease in Patrick's voice, full of warmth and promise. Robin felt her knees go weak, but she pushed her book aside and stood, moving past him to her desk. She could feel Patrick's eyes on her. He stepped to her side, so close, as she flipped through a spiral notebook. The heat of his body beside hers made her stomach twist with longing. She ripped 4 classes worth of notes on creation myths from the notebook and turned quickly, pages in hand, so he couldn't see she was trembling. "That's the last 2 weeks. You haven't been for a while." He looked down into her eyes, and she felt her breath catch.
"Saved my ass. I owe you."
Waverly's voice came from behind, a shrill note of warning. "Are you finished coming all over my roommate?" Patrick winked at Robin, turned and hoisted Waverly's suitcase, then his duffel bag, and then hooked an arm around Waverly's waist and slung her up over his shoulder in a fireman's carry. Waverly pounded on his back, her voice rising to a banshee shriek. "Put me down, you asshole!" Patrick ignored her and carried her out, calling cheerfully back over his shoulder.
"See ya, Rob. Happy Turkey Day."
Robin could hear Waverly starting to swear a blue streak, her voice fading down the hall. She kicked the door closed behind them and stood still in the fading light. Chapter 3. By 5, the dorm was completely, eerily empty, halls dark and silent as the grave. Robin had expected to feel at least some relief at Waverly's departure. Instead, she felt a dread closing in on panic. She had never experienced the dorm without dozens of people in it. Deserted, it was much bigger than she'd realized, 3 stories and 2.5 wings of crooked corridors, confusing to navigate without the landmarks of familiar faces. All the floors looked disconcertingly the same when the doors were shut. And Robin hadn't really imagined how different it would feel, that there was a life force in the presence of others that pervaded the building. Even when she was in her own room, consciously unaware, her subconscious must have registered all the others. Now the hall was as empty and dead as a shell. Without people, too, the dorm seemed to lose its very insulation. The wind reached icy fingers through minute cracks in the walls, snaked its way up through the floorboards. The rain had started again, slanting and relentless, and with it a fresh assault of wind. The windows rattled like bones. The whole structure shifted and groaned on its foundation. And it had finally occurred to Robin that the communal bathroom was all the way down the hall. She'd have to leave her room in the middle of the night, when anyone could be lurking around, lying in wait for lone college girls stupid enough not to go home for vacation. No one could possibly hear her if she screamed and screamed. "Stop it," she ordered herself. "Go out there right now instead of being an idiot about it." She opened her door to a dark hall of closed doors, all locked to silent rooms. She took a breath and made her way down the corridor to the bathroom. She stepped through the doorway and pulled up short, stifling a gasp. There was someone else in the bathroom. A slim girl with a wild mane of questionably blonde hair was leaning over one of the sinks lined up under the long horizontal mirror. Her mouth was pursed in concentration as she outlined her already blackened eyes with coal. Her torn lace blouse and short skirt revealed an elaborate navel piercing and several provocatively placed tattoos. A piece of red yarn was tied around one wrist, knotted in several places and frayed at the ends. Some LA thing, no doubt. She positively reeked of California. The girl, Lisa, Robin thought her name was, had a room on the opposite side of Robin's floor. She had the paleness and perpetual yawn of a druggie, but there was an interesting fuck you fire in her eyes. In the 2 months of the short term, Robin had seen numerous boys leaving and entering her room at all hours of the night and day, almost never the same one, for even 2 days in a row. Lisa glanced at Robin sideways in the mirror, drawled, "Love these holidays." Robin felt again the blistering envy of the fierce, crackling life in the other girl. But this time, along with the envy, there was something more. A yearning, an uncharacteristic impulse to reach out. She hovered by the lockers, gathering the courage to ask the girl if she was staying. Then jumped as a voice spoke right behind her. "You coming or what?" Robin twisted around. A sullen, leather-jacketed young man with dyed black hair slouched in the doorway. Lisa half-smiled ambiguously, stuck the coal pencil behind her ear, and sauntered out past Robin, a hip-shot walk, oozing an indolent and perhaps slightly stoned sensuality. She disappeared in the direction of the stairwell with the boy. Robin stood looking at her own reflection in the mirror for a long time. Dark hair, dark eyes, dark clothes, dark, dark, dark. The harsh fluorescence hummed above her head. Beyond the tiled divider wall, a shower dripped. She reached out and put her hand on the mirror, blocking out her own face. Chapter 4. The wind felt along the building outside, scratching for entry, whispering to get in. Robin walked along the dark hall, past closed doors, moving inexorably toward a door at the end with brilliant light along the cracks of it. The whispering was all around her, growing as she approached. Louder. Louder.
The door crashed open, tearing from its hinges, unleashing a storm of formless, swirling energies, howling with rage, rushing forth. Robin woke to a dim gray light, her heart pounding crazily in her chest. The shutters banged steadily against the window. The wind moaned as rain pelted down, icy, miserable. She lay still, burrowed in bed, unnerved by her dream, the images of incoherent swirling things. She'd fallen asleep while trying to read Jung's explanation of archetypes. She could feel the heavy lump of book beside her in the bed. That's where the swirling things had come from. She reached for the book and looked down at the page. The archetype is an irrepresentable, unconscious, pre-existent form that seems to be part of the inherited structure of the psyche and can therefore manifest itself spontaneously anywhere, at any time. Robin wasn't sure she understood the concept, but there was something disturbing about it. A pre-existent form that could spontaneously manifest itself anywhere, at any time. Not exactly something she wanted to hear this weekend. In fact, everything about Jung so far was unnerving. A man who'd begun his psychological studies back in the 1920s by going to seances, which, although cool, was somehow not what she'd expected to be studying in college. She looked out the window at the wind churning the trees and shivered. Then her stomach growled almost comically, and she realized she was starving. She stared out at the storm in dismay. She hadn't thought about food, or that there would be too much of a gale outside for her to try for a convenience store or for the lair on campus, which, she suddenly remembered, would be closed over the holiday anyway. She made a quick mental inventory of the stock on her closet shelf. It was as bleak as the day. A box of Triscuits, some packages of instant cocoa, and a stack of the student's friend top ramen, none of which was even remotely appealing. Waverly never ate, of course, though Robin knew there was an emergency bottle of Jack Daniels hidden behind her spare comforter on the top shelf of her closet, kept around to wash down the designer pain medication Waverly no doubt lifted from a mother as blonde and petite and shrill as she was. Robin's only hope of food was a trip to the second floor, where a communal laundry room housed a Coke and candy machine, and there would surely be coffee and perhaps someone's leftovers in the kitchenette. But that meant going out into the hall. She lay under the pile of comforters as long as she could, clinging to the warmth, until caffeine withdrawal forced her up. She dressed randomly, a skirt over wool leggings, a bulky sweater over a turtleneck, black on black, while rain pelted against the window behind her. Her door creaked open into the corridor as she stepped carefully outside her room. With all the doors closed, the hall was dim, spooky, far too reminiscent of her dream. She glanced toward the end of the hall, but of course there was only a wall, no door edged with brilliant light. She stood uneasily in the doorway, listening for any sound. Nothing but the wind scraping along the building outside. A fragment from Lister's lecture hovered in the back of her head. Jung believed there was a universal unconscious around us, populated by ancient forces that exist apart from us, yet interact with and act upon us. She eased the door closed behind her, irrationally not wanting to disturb the silence or draw attention to herself. What are you afraid of? Archetypes? She mocked herself. That's mature. She hurried down the carpeted hall, descended a flight of pitch-black stairs as quickly and silently as she could manage. The second floor was as deserted as her own, a dark tube of locked doors. Blue light spilled from the open doorway of the laundry room. Robin swallowed and crossed the hall. Inside, she reached along the wall and flicked on the light,
grateful for the spluttering glare of the fluorescents. The washing machines were silent cubes, the dryers black, watching windows against the wall. Robin walked past the line of washers to the lighted Coke machine, a cheery red in the monochromatic room. She reached into her skirt pocket, slid in quarters until a Coke can dropped into the tray with a sharp clunk. Robin flinched, raw-nerved at the sound. Behind her, there was a huge inhalation, like a rush of breath. Robin gasped, whirled, and stared at the generator, which had whooshed on behind her. She ran all the way back to her room and slammed the door behind her, leaned against it, shaking, berating herself, and wondered how she could possibly make it through 3 days. The phone call came right after noon, just as she'd known it would. When she picked up her phone, her mother was drunk, of course. Robin could almost smell it through the airwaves. Sweet, stale whiskey. 'Tis the season, though for Mom, any old season would do. Robin had carefully explained, the last time she'd called and found her mother not too out of it, that she'd be staying at school over Thanksgiving. Her mother had seemed to absorb it at the time. But somewhere along the line, something must have been lost, and her mother had missed the fact that Robin wasn't going to be coming home. Now her voice was edged with hysteria. Robin tried for calm. "I told you, Mom. I can't leave. I have a huge exam next week. Practically everyone's staying. We're having a big dinner here." She flinched and held the phone away from her face. Drunken rambling came from the earpiece. She sank down on the window seat, looked down at a lone student, head bent against the rain as he crossed the deserted street. The wheedling and cajoling segued into recrimination, and then the crying jag. Robin rested her forehead against the cold glass. The words didn't matter. She'd heard it before. It was all some dark, unfathomable mass, a vortex of chaos and confusion. Her mother was screaming now. Her father again. Always her father. "You're just like him, lying, selfless bitch." Robin choked out. "I gotta go, Mom. I gotta go." She punched off the phone and hurled it against the wall. It bounced under her desk and she backed away, swaying, sick. Instantly, it began to ring again. She threw herself down on the floor, groped under her desk, found the phone next to the wallboard. She pushed down on the power button until the ringing stopped. She sat back on her knees, hugging herself, feeling her mother's energy like a bottomless whirlpool, taking her down. Down. It wasn't him she was afraid of being like. That was where she came from. That was what she was. Broken, defective, fatally abnormal. No wonder no one wanted to come near her. It was all black, all nothingness. The abyss. Pure dark now. The rain gusted outside. The trees shivered in the wind. The hall shuddered in its own kind of agony, impervious to the one human sound deep within it. But something in the dark corridors leaned forward, listening. Robin was tightly curled in the window seat of her room, arms wrapped around her knees, sobs tearing through her. The blackness had descended again, leaving no room for anything else. After a long while, she looked up, drew a shaky breath. Her chest hurt from crying, but now, suddenly, she was calm. Exhausted, but deeply calm. She stood, swiped at her eyes with an overlong sleeve, and crossed unsteadily to Waverly's bureau. She knelt on the brown carpet and opened the bottom drawer, pushing aside sweatshirts and petite tees in pastel colors, to find the bottle of Valium. She shook it,
more than enough. And suddenly, she was clear. Chapter 5. The wide main staircase descended into the murky gloom of the bottom floor, lighted only by red neon exit signs. Robin stood at the top of the stairs with Waverly's bottle of Jack Daniels in one hand, the bottle of pills in the other, looking down into the abyss. She'd cracked the bottle in her room, even swallowed the first pill, washed down with whiskey, and immediately realized that not under any circumstances was she going to have Waverly be the one to find her. She could just hear the shrill screaming, the exaggerated hysteria. In the lounge, she could abandon herself to the infinitely more acceptable kindness of the first returning stranger. She swayed slightly, brushing against the banister, but she didn't feel drunk at all. A dreaminess had come over her. Now that she'd decided, everything seemed so easy and simple. Not that she hadn't thought of it before, but thinking wasn't the same as deciding. Deciding was freedom. She started down the stairs. The shining floor below reflected the dark red lights, creating the strange impression that she was descending into a lake. In fact, she felt as if she were moving through water, a trance-like, not unpleasant feeling, a bit like having no body at all. There was a distant roaring in her ears, like a vacuum, like the sea. Down she went, and down. The roaring became more distinct, whispering like a million formless voices overlapping. She wasn't alone, she realized with crystal clarity. But the thought wasn't frightening. Not at all. They wanted her, the voices. They were welcoming, beckoning. She stepped off the last stair, was jolted back to reality as her foot hit the floor. It was solid after all. And the voices were gone. She stood for a moment, then moved across the red streaks of light into the dark main hall, toward the high, arched doorway of the lounge. It was empty, a long, deep room with faded Victorian elegance. Once a grand parlor, it was now used as a common living area. Robin paused in the archway and felt the heaviness of time emanating from the room. It was like a stage set waiting for the players, dark walnut paneling and tall arched windows. On one end, a cluster of heavy scarred tables etched with decades of graffiti in front of a wall of built-in bookshelves. On the other end, a separate cluster of battered, sagging couches in front of an ornate fireplace, creating distinct lounging areas for studying and for TV. A dusty chandelier hung from the molded ceiling. A cloudy mirror cast rippled reflections over the hearth. A few lamps at the periphery of the room were on very low, lamps with hideous gold-painted plaster bases. They always seemed to be on, like nightlights, perhaps an attempt to keep drunk students from falling over themselves when they stumbled in late at night. Robin walked the length of the lounge unsteadily, her shoes sinking deeply into the worn, plum-colored carpet with cabbage roses. The room seemed immense to her, the walls distant shadows. She finally reached the other side and lowered herself into an overstuffed chair near the fireplace. The chair swallowed her, a comfortable paralysis. The rain pounded outside. The wet night shone blue through the arched windows. Robin stared into the gloomy depths of the unlighted hearth, uncapped the bottle of Jack, and took a deep slug. The whiskey raced through her like amber fire, a fierce, tingling burn. She blinked back tears and drank again. She sank deeper into the chair, her body heavy and loose. She turned over her palm dreamily to look at the bottle of pills. They rattled dryly inside the orange plastic. A good few dozen. Freedom.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.